Frank, thank you for the introduction and welcome to the tutorial course. I will try to talk for approximately an hour or so on application of reactive sputtering. This is a course we developed for SVC. In fact, I have to give credit to Bill Sproul, who at some point was not able to deliver this course, and he built the platform and bringing me in the topic, and we developed our course of his first input on that. So the course usually is been held by my colleague Holger Gerdes and myself, and you will receive the contact details later. Anyways, there's some contact details already available. The planned outline of the course for today is, of course, I will start with a motivation why we should consider reactive sputtering. What the heck is the reason we need reactive sputtering in our business? Some basics on sputtering, on the situation of what is happening, what's the base technology, and of course the basics of reactive sputtering. And I think those areas I will cover fully because that's the most important part on it. There is information on modeling, how you can go through some theories on the reactive sputtering. There is some need, especially on the industrial scale, to control the reactive sputtering, to be sure that you are in the proper composition of your process. And therefore, you need different options how you can do that. So there's plan to speak also on some sensors on feedback control. And for the end, I also will talk on a special topic on sputtering on reactive high PIMs, on high power impulse magnetron sputtering. But of course, I put together a lot of slides, a lot of information, and honestly, I don't believe I will walk through all those slides, but that will give you the chance to attend a half a full day course in line of the SVC TechCon on site or at some occasions. And most likely I will stop in approximately an hour from now and then we can go into some Q&A. So if we consider thin film technology and sputtering, we in most of the cases have to deal with compound layers. In reality, if we face the truth, sputtering is mainly not dealing with pure metal or pure elements, but in most of the cases, it's reactive sputterings. So pure metallic coatings are used maybe in mirrors or compact discs, but most of the used materials is carbides, nitrides, oxides, and so on. So there's a list of compound materials that are very common. So we have several oxides from highly insulating oxide to also transparent conductive oxides. We have nitrides in several modification or carbides. And some of those processes can be run easily by just adding some reactive gas without the need of any control. Some of them might become more sophisticated and difficult that you would need to pay attention to really keep a sound film property stoichiometry and to achieve the properties of your product. So one example is given here. This shows our SkyBridge at the Institute with electrochromic glazing where you can switch and you can manage the temperature, for example. You can manage the heat. You also can use decorative effects. So there's a lot of things. Even you can play with a glass facade in that kind of in that application, and you want to pay attention for how you can realize it. And most of that are dielectric films where you might need a control. A very common approach is a broadband anti-reflective coating. A quite simple case is a four-layer stack. So you have a stack of different layers with high refractive index, low refractive index. And if you do properly right, then you can get rid of a lot of reflection and you can reduce the reflectivity to maybe from 8.4% to approximately 1%, and you have a clear view what you, for example, want to have when you look in a showcase somewhere. You don't want to see your mirror image in the window, but you want to see what's behind the showcase. So if you go to the anti-reflective coatings a little bit more in detail, but I will not go too much into physical details, rather than more address some general topics, some general understanding, and more from the practical application and practical terms. So you have a sequence where you go for the glass, and then you have a thickness of 0.25 lambda quarters, then you have a next stack with 0.5 lambda quarters, and then there comes another one with 2 lambda quarters and lambda quarters, and it's a stacking sequence in that case. Here given an example of titania and silica films with some the rough numbers of the film thickness you would need for such an anti-reflective coating. So if we do reactive sputtering, of course we do sputtering. And so just a few words, you all, I believe, are familiar with the sputtering. Sputtering in general is ions and atoms playing billiards. So it was discovered even in 1853 by Grover and 1854 by Faraday. And originally it was seen as a dirt effect. So there were some metal deposits from walls of a glass discharge tube, but it was rightly ascribed as an erosion of the cathode. So that was the base history. So if we trace back, it's more than 160, almost 170 years where we find the roots of sputtering. And sputtering is not evaporation, it's sublimation. So we really bypass the liquid phase, we go directly from the solid phase to the gaseous phase, to the single particles. And also there's a difference in the particle energy. So the energy of the particles in sputtering have 10 times more energy or even higher depending on the process you're running compared to evaporation. So what we're doing is we have an incident ion hitting a solid state surface where we have the solid state lattice. And by hitting the surface, there can be some secondary electrons. They also will play later role on also in the reactive process, some effects we can observe there. We will have implanted ions that just go in the sublattice. We have the sputtering process where we have a collision cascade of several atoms, 1,000 atoms, and the impulse modification transfer, having a back impulse to get rid of some of the surface atoms for sputtering. And we might also reflect the ions. So secondary electron emission, ion implantation, sputtering, ion reflection, and we generate heat. We just get lattice vibration and we introduce heat into our lattice. So just a short summary on that, the collision cascade, we have an energy transfer to the solid state atoms where we can produce high energy collision products in a certain volume beneath the target surface. And so we will have a impulse transfer, we will have some changes that's maybe in the range of a few 10 nanometers, there could be even more than around 1,000 atoms involved. And we can release surface atoms for sputtering. And one comment, so in general, about nearly all the material, about 99% of the spotted particles are neutral. And there's a major exception. If there's enough time, we will end up with high PIMs that allows for a significantly higher amount of ionized spotted species, but it also will have some implication and some other effects on the reactive. If we want to deposit compound layers, we introduce some reactive gas that is added to the process gas to argon. So if we want to have oxides, of course, oxygen. If we want to have carbides, we have hydrocarbons in any combination, or nitrogen can be atomic. And that's just some schemes for the formation of the different compounds that we want to have. And of course, we want to achieve a desired stoichiometry of the compound. So in spot ring, we sputter, we have the ions removing, having the impulse transfer, propagating to the substrate surface where we form the film, and then we have our reactive gas in the plasma. And we have the reactions and we have the film formation. We will form a compound layer on our substrate from our target material and from the reactive gas molecules that are available. So in principle, if we speak of reactive DC sputtering, the target is usually conductive. So we cannot sputter an insulating material with DC. And the molecules can be built on the surface of the target, on the surface of the substrate, or on the chamber walls. So in general, if we form a compound, the compound in any case or with nearly 100% probability will be formed at any of the walls of our vessel or on the substrate itself. And the main problem we have is that most of the desired compounds are highly insulating. And so if we say the compound also forms on the target, that means we build up an insulating layer on the target, but in the end, our discharge will die off in that situation. So we want to have a highly stable coating process. If we use a reactive magnetron sputtering, we can go ahead without a feedback control. So we just use a reactive DC. We have a metallic target. We run the target. We apply a reactive gas to the process. And depending on the compound that's formed, depending on our reactive gas, there will be some poisoning. The process might die off, or we have some stable situation where we can run a reliable process. If we want to bypass that, and especially also in the case of insulating material, we can use RF sputtering. With RF, we even can sputter insulating materials. And to compensate for maybe some shift when we get into some insulating buildup on the target by the reactive compounds, we can go for a reactive RF sputtering from the metallic target in a mixed atmosphere. If we go for feedback control, we can improve, we can go for mid-frequency that allows for even getting rid of some of the charges on our target surface with the pulsing, and we can introduce the reactive gas and can get a long-term stable process. So just moving from the sputtering, already scratching some of the ideas of reactive DC sputtering, but without going into any deeper details on what is really happening. Now let's move to the basics for the reactive sputtering. So again, and there might be some slides, and that's part also of the courses when we build them up, that come maybe in a little bit modified form a few times, because of course everyone learns by just repetition. And if you think, okay, the guy told that before, you probably got it already. Otherwise, maybe there's a different aspect you can grab at that point. So reactive sputtering, as we address it, will be a mainly metallic target and a reactive gas that in combination provides the elements to form the compound that we want to have. And we want to have a controlled addition of our reactive species that we end up with a well-defined stoichiometry of the S-deposited films. The problem or the challenge, and we come to that in the course of a few more slides, there might be some hysteresis behavior occurring and we have to deal with that. So looking back historically, first tries were on flow control. You just run your process, you sputter with an inert gas and you introduce your reactive gas. You might use a needle valve or you might use a mass flow controller. The problem on the situation might be you introduce some amount of reactive gas and you get the reactions, like we pointed out, on the target surface, on the walls, on the substrate, And in the case on the target surface, you form a compound that might be insulating. And maybe as a general remark, most or nearly all of the compounds you will have a lower sputtering yield than the pure metal. That means it will be a self-amplifying effect that you reduce the sputter yield, you create more compound, and then you poison your target. And if it's insulating, the process might die off in that case. So what to do? We try to aim at the reactive gas partial pressure. So what's the reactive gas partial pressure? It's the pressure of reactive gas in the chamber, and maybe to better understanding, so the sum of the partial pressures that we have available in our system results in the total pressure. So this might be, if we have a vessel, we only have argon in that, so the pressure equals the partial pressure of the argon, and that's the pressure we are operating. If we have a mixture of two gases, for example, we can assume it like glass, for example, with two liquids, and they fill up to the same level. So that's the total pressure, but they consist of two different kinds, maybe of an oil and water, so that you can see it separately. Of course, you will have the interaction. So in that case, the partial pressures of our argon and our reactive gas will add up in the total pressure. So partial pressure depends on the gas flow in the chamber, the amount of gas we introduce in the chamber. It depends on the pumping speed. It depends on the power to the target, because that provides a lot of the metal particles for the reaction. And that provides the spotted species that can form the compound with the reactive gas. And we will have getter pumping. So we will have walls, we will have surface areas that can react. There will be reactions between the spotted species and the reactive gas. And that mainly occurs at the target, at the substrate, and at the walls. It, by means of physics, does not occur in the gas phase. And of course, there will be a difference whether we have the power on and we have a plasma running, or whether the power is switched off and we just introduce the gases. So I was speaking about the compound being formed on the surfaces. Why is that the case? Isn't there a chance to form the compound already in the gas phase? The answer is given here in that slide. So we must meet the conservation of energy and momentum requirements. We have to follow the laws of the physics. So there might be some situation, we might need some activity, some activation energy, maybe some dissociation, or we have some molecules and different reactivities in the situation. But if we have a gas molecule and we have our sputtered atom and we have a collision, if we have a two-body collision, we don't fulfill the requirements of the conservation of energy and momentum. We would need a three-body collision, but this probability is very low to have three particles in our low-pressure process to fulfill the requirements of physics to form the compound in the gas phase. So we can almost neglect that, and we can draw the conclusion the reactions will take place on any surface provided in our coating system. That's the target surface. We don't want to have too much of the compound formed there, because we want to run mostly metallic to have the highest rate. We will learn in a few minutes. It can form on the sidewalls, on our shieldings or whatever. We also don't want too much there. And where we want to have the formation will be on the substrate, and it should be the desired stoichiometry of our film. So I already was mentioning several times, we don't want to have the reaction on the target surface. So what is happening at the target? And that's a cross section you should imagine. It should depict the target. So just one racetrack, one area of the racetrack. So when you have linear or cylindrical target, you usually have a round or oval shaped racetrack. And so here you have the racetrack, and there might be some in the case of oxygen. When you introduce the oxygen, you will form some oxide, and there will be a competition between the growth of your oxide film and the sputtering rate. And if the sputtering rate is higher and exceeding here, you will keep the racetrack open and sputter metal. But if the sputter rate is lower than the oxide formation, of course, you will build up an oxide film, and you will maybe grow a compound film on your target surface. And what I mentioned before, usually also the sputter rate of the compound is lower than the sputter rate of your pure metal in that case. So I would like to take you step by step through the process of reactive sputtering. So let's start with a very simple picture. We have our target, we have our chamber, our vacuum chamber that's grounded, we have our substrate here, and we have vacuum, we have our exhaust to the pump, and we introduce some reactive gas to get started, to have some operation pressure where we can ignite a plasma. We attach a voltage to our target and we ignite a plasma. We create a plasma discharge and we accelerate our gas ions to the target and we start sputtering. So we start in a pure metallic mode. The target material will be sputtered and will deposit and will condense anywhere on any surface of our chamber, preferably on the substrate, but also on any walls that are available. So now we start introducing some reactive gas, for example, oxygen. We add some oxygen, and what we see, if we consider the partial pressure, and so remember the partial pressure is, if you consider that glass with the two liquids, the amount of oxygen we introduce. Interestingly, if we see the flow, we introduce some flow, and it can happen that the oxygen partial pressure nearly doesn't change. So we still have a purely metallic situation. And that can be understood by the situation that most of the oxygen is just captured away by reacting with the metal on the surfaces, on the sidewalls, on the substrate, or even on the target, and forms already the compound. So in the gas phase, we hardly see any oxygen at that point. So we increase the oxygen flux further. And what we see is the areas that are covered and filled with oxide now become larger and larger. And we also can detect some more oxygen in the gas in the system. And then at some point, a sudden jump happens. We can observe a sudden jump. We have a high flux of oxygen. And at that point, all the sidewalls are covered with oxygen, and there might be even our racetrack being filled with the compound, leading to a poisoned stage. If we further increase, we will now have a linear increase of the oxygen, but we will have a low sputtering rate, and we will not get rid of any of the oxygen, and we have compound formed everywhere in the chamber. So if we now reverse it and we reduce the amount of oxygen, we reduce the oxygen flow back to lower levels. We go beyond this point where we had the sudden jump and decrease the oxygen, but still we have all the sidewalls covered with compound. That means they are not able to capture any oxygen from the gas phase by gathering them as a getter pump and forming the compound because they are already oxidized. So we have to further reduce it to open up the racetrack or to even sputter more and more of the metal to provide some more metal for forming the compound. Even so, we have enough oxygen available to form any compound as soon as a metal arrives somewhere on some of the walls, and we still will have the compound. And at some point, there will be a jump down, and we will fall back here, and then we will have enough metallic species again. We will have some metallic areas, and we can reactivate a second pump in the system, the getter pump. So the walls that are metallic that can capture away oxygen by reacting and forming the compound. And this phenomenon we can see here is the hysteresis that occurs. There's also a nice movie I brought along from a colleague of mine who was modeling the process. So what you can see here is the cross-section of an industrial chamber. That's a cross-section of industrial sputtering cathode, 750 millimeters in height. It's a dual cathode arrangement, but we just observe operation of one cathode. So you can see here the color coding of the oxide coverage. This applies for the walls. So we start up with a metallic wall at the moment in green, and you can see the oxygen partial pressure, the color code here. So we don't have any oxygen at the moment, so everything is blue, and there might be some oxygen introduced in the system. And if we now introduce the oxygen, we will see what is happening. So we see the plasma is shrinking. The plum we see here is shrinking, and it becomes more and more oxygen available, and the walls become more and more covered with compound. So we form the compound, we form the desired compound layer, but we also get a modification of the plasma extension, and we get in the end a situation where even in a DC operation, the plasma could die off and we have a high excess of the oxygen. So this would be operation in a fully poisoned mode in that situation as an example. So what we've learned by this sketch and step-by-step process is we have to deal with a hysteresis behavior. So this increase in coverage of our target surface with the reaction products, here in the given case with oxygen, we see there is a decrease in the sputter yield. There is a change in the secondary electron emission. There might be an increase or a decrease. That depends on the element you have. And it will lead in the end to the so-called hysteresis behavior of the discharge. So you have two different stable operation modes. The one stable mode is the metallic mode. So you're running metallic and you have a high deposition rate. The erosion trench is free of any reaction products. Unfortunately, you won't form the compound. You have a high rate, but it's not the desired compound or stoichiometry. The other one is the compound or oxide or poison mode. There are different names available for that. To be not just stick to oxygen, I would speak mainly then of the compound mode. That means we have a full coverage of our target. The erosion trench is completely covered by the reaction products. We are sputtering even compound from the target if it's still conductive and the plasma will not die out, but we will have a very low deposition rate. So both extremes probably don't work for our process. We want to be in the intermediate regime, in the transition mode, that's somewhere in between the metallic and the reactive or the compound mode. But the problem is stable operation is or can become a challenge, as we have seen in the hysteresis with the jumps between the two stages of the compound and the metallic mode. Transition mode is characterized by a partial coverage of the erosion groove or erosion trench in that. And we can see this hysteresis behavior in different situations. So we can see it from the reactive gas partial pressure. Of course, if we introduce a reactive gas without a discharge, we just get with the reactive gas flow a linear increase of our reactive gas partial pressure for a given constant current in that situation, discharge current. But if we go with plasma, there might be a long time where we increase the reactive gas flow and we are getting a lot of the reactive gas. We don't see a big change if we monitor the reactive gas partial pressure. And then we jump up here and we will move in that direction. And going back, there will be a jump here at a lower amount of the flux. And the points A and B indicate the transition. A indicates the transition from the metallic to the compound mode, and B again is for the transition back again from the compound mode to the metallic mode. We can observe the same in the cathode voltage, where we see a drop, but there you have to be careful. Whether it's a drop or whether it's an increase, a rise in the voltage, depends on the secondary electron yield of your desired material, of the compound forming material. And there are elements that will have an increase and that, or a decrease of your secondary electron yield, and that will result in increase or decrease of your voltage. So here, let me talk for aluminum oxide, for instance. You will see from the metallic mode a drop in the cathode voltage when you move to the oxide or compound mode, and getting back again, you will see the voltage rise in that. And with that connected, you have the deposition rate. You see a similar situation. You start with a high rate in the metallic mode, and then you fall down to a low rate, a very low rate in the compound mode, and again, coming back in the metallic. And you probably want to operate somewhere in the intermediate with a rate as high as possible, but still keeping the target metallic, but creating a defined compound on your substrate during the deposition. And coming back to the picture of the target surface in the stable conditions, what I've showed before, and I already walked through this picture in the metallic mode, there might be at the edges or at some redeposition zone, some compound, some oxide formed, but the racetrack in sputtering is mainly clean and you spot a metal. And in the compound mode, you have more than enough of the reactive species available and you form a compound and your sputtering rate is lower than the compound formation. So you will have a compound that you're sputtering from your target during your process. There are different parameters you see in the reactive sputtering. I mentioned we kept the current constant and then we see a modification or variation of the voltage. We have the flux of our inert gas of usually argon. We have the flux of the reactive gas, the amount of reactive gas available. And if we have the surface reactions, this must not directly be linked to the partial pressure. So if we have a lot of getter processes, reactions on the walls, occurring, the reactive gas partial pressure might be low, even so you introduce a quite high amount of reactive gas or you have a quite high reactive gas flow and you have the total pressure where you're operating. So now we've went through the sputtering, the reactive sputtering. We've learned already that with the reactive sputtering, we have to deal with hysteresis behavior. There will be hysteresis and occurring. And of course, the question is there a deeper understanding? And there are several groups, for example, quite popular, Søren Berg from Uppsala or Uppsala University, dealing with reactive sputtering and the modeling of reactive sputtering, or also Dietrich Deppler in Ghent and his group. They do a lot of work and information and provide also software and models for reactive sputtering. And there's many models available on reactive sputtering over the years. I will focus on some basic information on the model from Professor Berg on the Berg model for reactive sputtering. And I will skip for the sake of time here, the reactive sputter deposition models from the Ghent University, but feel free to look at the University Ghent of the group of Dietrich Deppler. There's also some simulation modeling software available where you can play around in the other courses, in the full scale courses, we will go into some details, even do some small modeling description on how we can observe the hysteresis, what's influencing the hysteresis during the turn of the course. But we will skip it here in that short version we are talking about. So just to start with, some motivation, that's some results we had on our commercial machine. That's an industrial inline coder. We have a rotating cathode. We have a setup of two cylindrical cathodes with a length of 550 millimeters, so a bit more than half a meter. Target length, metallic aluminum targets. We have a mid-frequency process alternating, having one cathode and the other cathode alternatively serving as a cathode or anode of the two tubes. And what you can see here is the cathode voltage over the oxygen flow. We start up at some level of the voltage and we increase the gas flow, and we see the voltage levels at some value in that case for the given setup and the magnetic configuration around 460 volts, something like that. And then you can see here already the onset where the voltage is dropping, where you see there is something happening. That's what we see with the wall coverage, with the reactions, before we have the sudden jump and the fall. And you see a huge drastic decrease of the cathode voltage in that case when we go to the poisoned mode. And then going back, reducing the oxygen flow again, we see we stay at that low level, and that's also associated with the low deposition rate. And then we jump up here when again the surface becomes clean and metallic and we have more or mostly metallic particle species available and form the reaction, and we are back again in the metallic mode here. And if we take this hysteresis, we have different effects we can consider, and that can also be nicely described by a model. So the Berg model addresses different aspects. So let me talk and guide you through here to the flux of the reactive gases that we have available. So we introduce in our system our reactive gas. So we have a total flux of reactive gas that's introduced in our coating chamber. And this gas has different options where to go. So the simplest way is this fraction of the gas goes directly to the pump down the drain, is gone, is not available for any reactions. Then we have a fraction that's moving to our target area. On the target area, there is some surface area, some fraction where we have some compound formed on the target. So if you remember, maybe outside the racetrack, there might be some redeposition. So there is a fraction of the target area that's covered already with compound. So there is some oxide, there won't be any reaction to a compound because there is already compound. But there's also a fraction, 1 minus zeta T, that is still metallic. On that metallic, imagine an oxygen arriving. This will form an oxide, or if it's nitrogen, form a nitride, and will contribute to increase the fraction of the compound covered area of the target. On the other hand, we also have all the other collecting areas. So we just reduce it to all collecting areas, including the substrate. Of course, in the application, we will focus on the substrate because that's where we want to have our coating. So going one step back, that was too fast. So we have the flux going to our collecting areas, and there's the same situation. We have areas that are covered with compound, and we have a fraction that's not covered with compound. And all the areas that are not covered with compound, they will contribute, form a compound, and do the reaction and have the compound and catch away some of the reactive gas. So the reactive gas is consumed by the collecting areas that are metal covered, by the target area that is metal covered, and some of it, some fraction, is pumped away. And that's the input parameters, all the different parameters we can use for modeling our system if we consider the flux of the reactive gas. For the description, we also can focus on the flux of the material itself. That might be the other option. So again, we start with the target. We have the target. We have some of the target area that's covered with compound. That means we are sputtering compound moving towards our collecting areas. And this will be deposited on the collecting areas, either on already compound covered areas or on metallic areas. And for metallic pieces, the same situation. You sputter metallic and it will deposit a metal here or here on a compound or not. And then you have additionally, again, your reactive flux that will transfer any metallic areas into compound and form the compound on your collecting areas you want to introduce with that. The nice, if you take all those input parameters in the theoretic description, is the model nicely and accurately predicts some avalanche effects you would see in flow control, where you will have the sudden jump towards the poisoning from the metal to the compound stage. You will see and describe the decrease of the hysteresis when you increase the pumping speed in the system. So we've seen that the reactive gas will be pumped away, but also all the collecting areas function as a getter pump. And it also can show you and describe how you can work in the transition regime with a partial pressure control if you are able to control the amount of film-forming species and to tailor this so to keep your hysteresis in the transition in operation. And you can even have more than one gas for the reaction. So you also can consider, of course, not just one compound, but you can say compound A and compound B. So you can also apply this approach for description when using, for example, oxynitrites or so. Then you just add another element and the fluxes of both of the elements and the intermixing in that. So if you want to control the reactive sputtering, let's start with a very simple picture. Should be familiar for, I guess, all of you. When you're riding your car, you're somewhere on the road, you keep your car on the road, and you just suddenly see, oh, you're not on the German highway with unlimited speed. You have some speed limit. So you have to monitor your speedometer, and you do it as the driver yourself. Then you have your set point parameter. You correlate, is my speed correct? What says the speedometer? And then you go into a control loop. If you are too fast, you probably will trigger a reaction. You will go and take the brake, or you will just leverage your speed. You reduce the speed and take control of your car. And so you enter this control loop, and that's fully automatic. But in the end, that's exactly what you want to do when you want to control a hysteresis. You want to be in that loop where you jump between the too high and the too low, too fast, too slow, and keep the speed at some intermediate level in that loop. And you want to have that reverse loop. So in a more sophisticated scenario, more technical, you have your reactive sputtering process and you have different probes you can use, you could look at, and you can use as a control parameter. You have your discharge power. You can modulate the discharge power. If you attach a higher power, you sputter more material, you provide more metal for reactions. If you keep the reactive gas constant, you provide more reactive species, so you can shift from more of the poison stage to more metallic in that direction, or you can go for the oxygen flow So you reduce the oxygen flow, you reduce the amount of reactive gas available, and by that you also have more metal available. You turn it in that point. And of course, one of the input parameters could be the discharge voltage that gives you the indication, as we've seen before, where you are in your hysteresis. You can have, if you're dealing with oxygen, for example, a lambda probe that measures the oxygen partial pressure, that will go in your process control unit as an input parameter. And again, you can monitor and modify the power to the target or the oxygen flow or the reactive gas flow in the system. You could use a mass spec. You can get information on the oxygen, on the argon, on the metal species. You get a lot of information. You can use that as feedback parameter again. You can use means of optical emission spectroscopy, and you can measure different amounts of oxygen, argon, of metal, of the composition, or you can even use the voltage or harmonic analysis of the voltage by Fourier transformation, and you can use those functions as a feedback. In the film itself, if you monitor the film, you can use ellipsometry, RT photometry, and you can derive optical constants, film thickness, growth rate, and can take that as a feedback control for that. So the actuating variables, so that's your foot on your speedometer, would be the discharge power or the reactive gas flow that you can tailor. Your input variables, your control variables, could be the partial pressure, the voltage, time-resolved optic analysis, harmonic analysis of current or voltage, or any means of optical input, emission data, emission intensities. And you have a control unit. You can use a PID controller, FOSI controller, or expert system. And by just forming this system, you gain a precise control of the net flow of your film-forming species. So there are different options. You already have seen them in that busy graph. That's different sensors you can use for feedback control. So you can use lambda probe for measuring partial pressure, but this only applies for oxygen. You can go for mass spec. You can use means of optical emission spectroscopy, or you can use the voltage itself. So if we consider partial pressure, there are some basic requirements. So we have to be responsive to the changes in the partial pressure. So our lambda probe will not work for nitrogen. It will work for oxygen. And we have to respond to the partial pressure. Depending on the compound we're forming, we need a quite fast response to the signal, to the partial pressure changes, and we need a good signal-to-noise ratio. And the update time, how fast we can react, might be depending on the material. So, for example, when you're dealing with aluminum oxide, you have to react faster than when you're dealing with titanium. There might be some situation, and it had happened to us running the experiments. I think several of you might share this experience. If you're way too far in the poisoned mode or in the oxide mode, your plasma can die off and you can poison your target so hard that you have to rework, to regrind even your target before you are able to restart your process. And of course, you absolutely want to avoid this. So a lambda sensor measures oxygen partial pressure. It cannot measure other gases, but it can be nicely used for oxygen. You can use, for example, a solid electrolyte sensor, and you can measure, get out a voltage signal that's proportional to the oxygen partial pressure. And some of that types are used in automotive applications nowadays. You will have there. Benefit is it's quite simple to use. Once you have it calibrated, you get a direct pressure reading, and it's relatively cheap. So you have low costs. The drawbacks of this solution is it only works for oxygen. It's strongly depending on the mounting location where you place your sensor. There might be locations in your chamber where you can read out a signal, but you will not be able to control your process by that signal. And the response time may be too long for some of the materials. So for example, we also use, besides some other means, besides optical means, lambda sensors also in our industrial system on the 750 millimeter cathodes. And we have three lambda sensors, and they are differential pumped to fulfill the requirements to be fast enough in the reaction time. But then you need some differential pumping if you want to deal with that requirements. You can use a mass spec if you have some around. In many companies, it's rare. It's quite expensive. Of course, it allows you. It's a nice instrument. It's great. You get direct measurement of the gases in systems with its mass and charge. You get a lot of information on all the species available. You can sense oxygen, nitrogen. You can sense all different areas. For example, using a high-pressure quadrupole mass spec, it operates at sputtering pressures without any differential pumping. But you have to be careful. Oxygen can lead to some undesired shifts. Additional oxygen can decrease in all peaks to some areas. There could be some interaction with ionizer in the system. It might be not suitable as a reactive gas sensor for the oxygen. Benefits of the mass spec is you get a direct partial pressure signal of your species, and you get it for several species. You can follow any changes in your atmosphere during the whole process. You see evidently whether there's outgassing or leaks or things like that. It gives you a great access if you want to solve a problem. It can work nicely as a residual gas analyzer, and it's a very powerful instrument. But on the other hand, it's also a very costly approach, especially if you just want to go for the control of your system. Disadvantage, it depends on the system you're using. There might be some differential pumping that's required. It adds to the cost, even though you have already the most expensive sensor. There might be some signal drift with long runs on the long term. You can overcome that when you use the ratio of some peaks that will stay constant over time. So that's normally dealt quite easily with some software routine that can handle the drift. Optical emission spectroscopy. So since we are looking for plasma processes, we have light switched on. We can observe that light, and we can trace that light and get the information. So with the OES, we measure the generated light of the sputtering process. We can track individual wavelengths that correlate to reactive species or spotted species, and we can lock in to some specific wavelengths. We also can use a photodiode or photomultiplier or a filter arrangement. Sometimes with the processes, we might have some challenges with the oxygen because the oxygen signal might be a quite weak signal, but it's possible to detect and to run with that. So a benefit, you have a fast update time for your feedback signal. The cost is relatively low. You can consider, due to lower costs, maybe multiple sensors, especially when we're speaking about industrial system and a long cathode. There is a demand to also have a control over the length of the cathode. Otherwise, there might be some effects you neglect, and you want to have a homogeneous distribution over your cathode. And you can learn even more. You get additional background information. If there is some contamination, some outgassing, some leakage, you also can observe that in the optical emission. Some drawbacks, but I added some comments because you can handle that, and plasma emission monitoring or OES-based systems is quite common and established in production. Optics can be coded, so you can use a purge gas, you can use some specific configuration like honeycomb structures that capture most of the coding particles that you bypass the coding of your optics. The intensity of your monitored wavelengths varies with the target lifetime. When you have a target erosion, you also have a change in your magnetic field, you have a change in the impedance in the plasma, and that also can alter the intensity and the of your light and of the monitored wavelengths. So if you put in for relative intensities, you're on the safe side, then you can get rid of that. Moving substrates, especially when you have some ferrous ones, can affect by moving, by the movement, you get a shift of the plasma and you get some modulation. You have to deal with some averaging. You have to be careful where you're looking at. And if you consider this, it's fine. But you cannot distinguish between effects from multiple gases on the decrease of the signal intensity. When you have a certain metal line and the metal line decreases, you don't know which of the gases might contribute to the decrease. So you have to be careful with that, but it's established, it's a well-working, well-established system, and I think it's mostly commonly used. There is two different approaches to consider. It's plasma emission monitor, where you look with a certain wavelength, you have a filter, you have a certain wavelength, and you just observe the single wavelength. And in many processes, many applications, that's sufficient, that's more than enough. Or you can use OES-based systems where you provide a spectral range or a full spectrum and you get several lines and you can play around with even relative intensity and you can observe maybe even ionization and some other effects on top of that. So you can gain a lot of information more for your control. You can stick to the cathode voltage. It's nearly for free. Any power supply will give you a readout of the voltage. And you somehow, maybe you have to talk with your power supply vendor where to plug in or where to monitor the signal, but that's the easiest way. And then you can use it for the feedback. The plasma impedance varies with the change of the composition and the plasma charge, and that will directly give you an effect on the voltage. If you run your system at constant current or constant power, the voltage will shift and change and you get the readout signal. You get an indirect signal on that. The magnitude and direction of the change in the voltage depends on the material that you have and the magnitude. There might be some issues. So there are elements like ITO that only have a very small amplitude in change, or you can have a very large amplitude in the case of silicon oxide, for example. And then the direction I mentioned before, depending on the secondary electron emission, there might be some increase or decrease. But anyways, if you have the dynamic system and you know there is a change in voltage, it's attributed, you can use this to control your process. Benefit again, the signal can change very fast and you have a readout very fast. The signal is available. You easily can add it and it's virtually at no cost where you get the signal and you can get a very fast feedback. The drawback is the change is not unique. It might be for several reasons at constant target power. There might be a change in the plasma composition due to leakages, outgassing, some other reactive gases that can affect your readout system. On the long term, as a long-term effect, the target erosion will have an effect on your voltage. There might be a variation in argon pressure or in the operation temperature that also might have influence on the voltage. Or if you facing the disappearing anode problem when you're covering everything with compound that will result in a major change and some problems of that. I will go for a few more minutes, but I will stop somewhere in between for the reactive HIPAMs, just introducing some of the benefits I already pointed out at the beginning. In HIPAMs, we have the situation, or the other way around. In conventional sputtering, we are almost dealing in any case with neutral particles that form the film. In HIPAMs, we have the ions. So following the target pathway model derived by Dave Christie and improved by Jaroslav Wilczek, we start sputtering. We have an argon ion hitting the target, sputtering a target atom at a certain sputtering yield. This target atom can become ionized and we have a target ion. This can be back attracted to the target as target ion with some probability and sputter as target ion sputtering a target atom in that case. So we have a cycle here where we have sputtering additionally to the argon, to the gas sputtering. The neutrals also with one minus better probability will just propagate somewhere in the chamber, or the ions might propagate and with some probability there might be also some ionization in the plasma. We can have ions that form the film. That's mainly what we are aiming at in HIPAMs. And we can also lose some ions to the sidewalls or wherever. And the same situation applies for the neutrals. We can lose some, and some might also arrive at the target. And that's influencing the process. And what we know from literature is in HIPAMs, we can get denser coatings, higher hardness, tailored stress, and some other properties switch in crystal structure and so on. So it's an interesting process, but also here it becomes more complex than the conventional sputtering because also our target material can contribute to the sputtering process. There is some literature and it's all often mentioned that HIPAMs has the drawback because you lose rate. There's a nice paper from Jens Emmerlich on that, scientifically explaining why in HIPAMs you will have a lower rate because you don't have a linear increase in sputter yield with running your cathode at a higher target potential or higher energy. The physical details are found here. I just redraw that picture by taking the values from the sputter yield calculator. But, and that's the reason I just mention it here before I will stop and not guide you through all of that, but you will see it in any of the other courses if you attend. There is some literature also more than 10 years ago for zirconia. And the filled symbols indicate a metallic film. The open symbols indicate a compound film. So we start up in a DC process with a metallic film at a relatively high, in that case, normalized deposition rate. And then following the hysteresis and the mechanics of the compound formation, we have a significant drop in rate until we form the desired compound in the stoichiometry at a quite low rate here compared. In HIPAMs, at some configuration in that experiment, it was seen that already at the same level of the metallic mode, even though you start off at the lower normalized rate, you are able with the oxygen flow to form the compound you want to have. And in the end for the compound, it turns out to have a higher rate for the deposition. And this depends on also your pulsing parameters, what you choose. You might start up with a lower rate, but even so be higher than in the reference process on the same system. And always be careful if you are comparing apples with pears, that's not possible. You have to stay in the system, in the same surrounding, if you deal with that. And there's a lot of literature also. There might be some hysteresis-free transition. Yes, there are cases where you can even suppress the hysteresis in HIPAMs, but that's in industrial systems on large-scale cathodes, you will see a hysteresis. And there's also some indication that's quite nice. you have a pulse current shape in high pims where the pulse current has a different change whether you're in the metallic scheme or whether you're in the poisoned range. Even from that, you can see where you are operating in the hysteresis. And also the current is one of the parameters you could pick for stabilizing your process in high pims. There's a lot of reasons for narrow hysteresis for the case in high pims. We can talk to that, but I just would stop here and recommend if you're more interested, either to talk later on, to follow up with the discussion, to meet somewhere at a different event and location. And there's a nice paper explaining some of the basic approaches and ideas. And recently from Andrea Anders, there was a review paper on reactive high pims, also considering a lot of aspects explaining some of the effects in high pims running with reactive processes. And with that, I would hand back to Frank for the Q&A and for moderating the discussion in that.
Ralph, let me thank you for an absolutely spectacular presentation. We have one question right now from an anonymous attendee who has asked a question. Could you please go into a little bit more detail on how the harmonic content of voltage and current is used in process control?
Great question. I can't. It's a simple answer. I would ask my colleagues that are more in the modeling. So I'm more from the practical side in that before I try to tell you some fancy physical details I don't understand in detail, I'm happy if you send me that question to discuss with and I bring you in contact with the people that are more capable than I am to properly explain you what's happening there.
Are there, I see another question coming up. What are the most important considerations when making a choice between reactive sputtering of a metal versus reactive sputtering of a compound target?
In general, the point is, you can sputter anything with RF. When you go for reactive sputtering, the sputter rate is way higher. In general, the compound sputter rate always, I don't recall a case, there might be some physical exceptions, but in everyday life, as a rule of the thumb, all the compounds have a lower sputter rate than the pure metal. And if you keep your target mainly in the metallic and you add the compound, you are way faster for your process and for the production. And you can control the properties of your film if you do it properly to get excellent results in that. And of course, RF sputtering just applies for some certain area of target. You usually don't go for RF sputtering if you go to really big targets. That's DC or pulse DC usually. And so that's mainly the point. And what one practical example, we looked into aluminum oxide as insulating material for different applications for sensors, for example, for a thin film strain gauge for insulating against voltage. And if you want to deposit a high quality aluminum film on larger scale, there are several approaches, also quite interesting. But in the end, it comes down how you run the process. You get nice results with RF, but it's a very slow process, and I think we have 10 times the rate and at least the same, even better properties in a reactive sputtering process that we can achieve.
Last and final question. Is there any rule of thumb in using DC and RF apart from conductivity of the target? Any other considerations?
So in general, RF always is more expensive. That's a general approach. So if you consider and look up for any of the RF power supplies, the price per kilowatt in RF is higher than in DC. The other thing is that the question on the process you're running, most of the materials you can run in DC operation is very stable. It's very straightforward and just easier. It's just an aspect of the costs mainly that you're doing, and why DC or pulse DC, especially on larger scale, is well established there. But I think there's a lot of application benefiting from RF, but if it comes to big areas to, let me say tool coating, let me say glass coating or so, you will be in the DC just for the price range.
Well, with that, let me thank you, Ralph, and certainly let me thank all of our attendees for taking the time out of their day to join us on our final webinar 2.0 series. Look forward to seeing you next year, either at our event or at an expanded version of this format as we get into 2021, and hopefully a bit of normalcy comes back to all of our lives. So be safe, everyone, and certainly have a wonderful and healthy holiday season. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye.